This lesson is about I wanted to share with you some lessons that we learned while maintaining the Python SDK for the oVirt project. That's the objective of the session. By the way, someone told me that I already won the prize for the longest title of the session in the conference. You? Longest name and longest title, yeah? So, well, the objective of the session is, as I said, sharing with you these lessons that we learned. And first I'm going to do a quick introduction of what is oVirt. How many people here knows what oVirt is? Well, it's not bad. Well, oVirt is basically a virtualization platform that allows you to manage virtual machines, to manage storage, to manage networks, and it has a nice graphical user interface designed for humans. And it also has a nice, I have to say that because I am the maintainer, REST API designed for use by other systems. And on top of that API, we also provide a Python SDK in addition to other SDKs. And the Python SDK is basically a Python library designed to simplify usage of the API. Basically, it tries to remove from the developer the complexities of dealing with the HTTP protocol and with the XML parsing and rendering. That's the idea. Not much more than that, not less than that. Okay, that's the idea of the Python SDK. Simplifying things for Python developers. To give you an idea of how it works, this is how you will have to use the API if you want to use just the HTTP protocol. You have to take care of sending a request like that, and you have to take care of authentication, you have to take care of sending the right headers, so on. You have to take care of URL encoding the parameters of the request, all those things, and then you will get back an XML document, and you have to take care of parsing that XML document and extracting information that you need. Okay, so this is quite, it's not really complicated, but it's not really useful. That's not a lot of value to your application. So that's what where the Python SDK should help you. This is how you do the same with the Python SDK. Instead of handling yourself the details of the HTTP connection, you just create a connection object, providing the parameters of that connection, including the username, the password, the kind of authentication that you want to use, the details for TLS checking, and so on. And then you start using the services that are provided by the API. For example, the API has a service that manages the collection of virtual machines. If you want to get the list of virtual machines, you first get a reference to that service, that VM service that you see there, and then you invoke the list method, which may have some parameters that will end up into the URL, and then you get back a list, a Python list, of what? Not of XML. What you get back is a Python list of Python objects that represent the objects that you are interested in this particular case, the VM. So that's the idea, hiding the details of HTTP and hiding the details of XML. That's the idea of what the SDK is for, okay? So this project has been in development since 2010, more or less, the development of the Python SDK. And during that time, we found a lot of issues and we found some solutions. There are still things to solve, but some are already solved. And these are the lessons that I want to share with you. Some of them, not all, because some of them are not relevant for Python developers. Some of them are not interesting enough. But I selected these four lessons that we learned when doing the Python SDK. First one is the need for an HTTP user specification of the API. Second one is try not to expose code in your API that you can't control. Third one is surprisingly, or maybe not, simple code performs better than smart code. And the fourth one is that latency is very important for performance. It will kill the performance of your application if you are not careful. So let's go for the first one, the need for a easy to use specification of the API. Okay? In the previous version of the API that we used to have, we had separate files that define the API itself. We had an XML schema that defined the types that can be exchanged with the API, and we have a homemade XML file called the RSDL, RESTful Service Description Language, that defined the operations that are available and the parameters for those operations. In order to generate the SDKs, because the SDKs are automatically generated, we had to mix those two things, and then from that extract the SDK, the information needed to generate the SDK. That was what we did. In addition, we generated part of the SDK using a tool called generateds.py. I'm not familiar if anyone here is familiar with generateds.py. Okay, it's a tool that generates Python code from XML schema. We use that to generate part of the SDK. Okay, and in addition to that, we also generated another part of the SDK using a custom code generator. And an important thing here is that the releases of the SDK were strongly tied to the releases of the server, because we needed actually a live server to extract the XML schema and to extract the RSDL, and then on top of that, we could build the SDK. So that was what we did. Why did we need to improve that? Basically, because the code generator was very complex and very hard to maintain, very expensive to maintain. The reason is that we had to take those two completely different sources, the XML schema and the RSDL, and then from that, we had to extract, to infer what we had to generate in the SDK. It was really hard to maintain. Another reason was that we also had other SDKs, like the Java SDK, and that means that we had to have that code, part of that code that generates the SDK, was repeated, duplicated in several places. Okay. So in order to improve that, what we did with the release of version 4 of oVirt, we changed the architecture of the SDK, and we did the following. We introduced a new separate specification of the API, kind of a formal specification of the API that defines in a single place with a single language the types that are part of the API and the operations that are part of the API. Okay. This makes it possible to have its own release cycle. So this specification is released independently of the server. Okay. And now the server and the SDKs that not depend on each other. They depend on the specification. So we have the specification here. The server depends on the specification. The SDKs also depend on the specification. So there is no this dependency between the two things. Okay? So that's the idea. Okay? That's the first one, the first lesson. Second one is try to avoid exposing code that you can't control. Okay? The situation we had before releasing version 4 of the SDK is that the SDK exposed two different kinds of Python classes. We call them params and brokers. Params were just the representations of the types of the API. Like, for example, you have a VM class that represents a VM, a disk class that represents a disk, so on. And brokers are classes, or where? Classes that extend the params and add operations, like the operation to update a VM, the operation to add a disk, and so on. And we used to generate the first types of things, the params, with this generateds.py tool. Okay? And we generated the rest of the code with a custom written code generator. One very important thing here is that in order to be able to use the params as the base classes for the brokers, we had to modify the code generated by generateds.py. You can imagine how complicated that is. You have a tool that generates code, and then you have another tool that reads that code and modifies it in order to satisfy your requirements. Really complicated, okay? So not very nice. Why did that need to be improved? Because we needed to make that simpler, okay? And we needed to get a way of generateds.py. Not because generateds.py is bad, but because we can't control it. So if a new release of generateds.py changes something in the classes that you are using, you are dead because you can't use it. Because our SDK has a backwards compatibility commitment, so we can't change anything in the API that we offer. So we had to remove that. Okay. Another reason is that the XML schema that we used was not exactly Pythonic, and the same happened with the generated code. Just take a look at this code. Okay? This is the code that we needed in order to do something as simple as creating a new disk. And you see there something like this. In order to create a disk, you have to provide an alias for the disk, the provision size, and also the set of storage domains where that disk should go. Okay? In theory, that should be just a Python list. But because of how we generated the code from XML schema, that had to be an object that contained another object, and that object contained a list that contained the disks. Really, really not nice. So we needed to change that. Okay. So what did we change? With release 4 of the SDK, we replaced generate.py with a tool that we wrote and that generates the code as we need it. Okay. Many will think, why are you reinventing this code generation if there are tons of tools that you can use for that? Well, the main reason is that, as I mentioned, okay? Can you rely on that, on the code generated by that tool as your contract for your API? What if the developer of that tool decides to do a minor change that breaks your backwards compatibility? It's really hard, okay? So we decided to do it ourselves, okay? For example, one of the things that we get as a benefit is that the code now is more Pythonic than before. Okay? We can get rid of that. And in addition, another important thing is that the code that we generate now is independent of XML. We completely separated the XML rendering and parsing from the types. So we can use any other tool to parse and render XML. Okay. So that's the second lesson. Third one is about the complexity of the code and being smart or just being sometimes even stupid. Okay. Sometimes stupid code performs better than a smart code. Okay. In general, we all think that smart code is better. Sometimes it's not. Okay. Let me show you what was the situation we had with version 3 of the Python SDK. We used to generate this code, as I mentioned before. We had the param classes generated from with this tool. We had broker classes extending the base classes. And in order to make that work, we had to do a lot of black magic, like a lot of use of inspect get members, a lot of use underscore dict, whatever, underscore name. We used that a lot in order to make this thing work. The result of that is that the parsing that we did, the complete solution for XML parsing, was very slow, especially for large documents, for large sets of information. Okay. In order to improve that, what we did in version 4 of the API and in version 4 of the SDK is that we replaced that tool, generate.ds.py, with an XML parser based on the libxml2 library. Maybe you know that tool. It's a very nice XML parser. And it has a very nice streaming parser mechanism, where you, instead of creating a huge document object model in memory, what you do is you receive events that tell you what is happening in the input document. Okay? So we wrote a wrapper around that library. It's written in C, because at the time we didn't have a better way to access that library. And we use that to generate simple code for parsing. So to show you an idea of what simple means. This is, for example, the code that we generate for a VM, for the VM type. You see, nothing special. It's a very simple, if not a stupid code. We have a constructor with as many arguments as attributes we have in that class. And we have as many attributes as attributes in that type. And for each attribute, we have just a setter and a getter. Nothing special, no traces here of XML rendering or parsing. This is completely independent of XML rendering and parsing. No relationship there. So this is the kind of code we generate for types. This is the kind of code we generate for XML parsing. Okay, the idea is that as we know in advance, because we have a specification, the structure of the VM, we can generate a specific code to parse a VM. And that code can be very simple, like this. How do you parse a VM? You ask for the input, give me the next input element. If it is, for example, look at this code here. Looks stupid, it's maybe stupid. If the next element is affinity labels, then pass the affinity labels. And we have a specific code for affinity labels. All those things are automatically generated. So this is very simple as well. Same for writing, same for generating XML. We have the same kind of simple code, okay, that is automatically generated. And the result of that is the following in terms of performance. Okay? That's an idea of how long it takes to read a file containing 4,000 VMs. As you can see in the first example, this is using what we had in version 3 of the SDK. It took that amount of seconds to parse that file. This is what we have in version 4. It takes that amount of seconds. Okay? It's something like 170 times faster. I have to say that that was the situation when we started to develop version 4 of the SDK. After that, we made several improvements to version 3 in order to make it better, but still, nowadays, version 4 is still two times faster in all situations than the version 4. Okay. Okay. So that's the idea of the how we simplify things. We made things more performant. Next thing is the next lesson is about latency. Something that you usually we usually forget when we do. When we develop, because we usually test with a server that we have here very close to us, and latency is not a problem. But in real situations, latency is a big problem. Okay? In addition, the typical use case for a program that you do with the SDK, with any SDK, is sequential. You usually do things like that. Okay? You get a connection to the server, and then you want to retrieve 100 VMs, you get the list of VMs, and then you want to retrieve the NICs of those VMs, you go into a loop, and then you retrieve them sequentially. Okay? What's the problem with this if you have high latency in your environment? You are sending one request for VMs, waiting some time, the latency. Then you are sending one request for the first VM, waiting. Sending one request for the second set of NICs, waiting. Sending another, you see, there's a lot of waiting there. And every waiting is waiting for the latency. So that's a problem. We wanted to improve this. And in order to do that, we decided to take advantage of using multiple connections, multiple TCP connections, and also HTTP pipelining. Okay? So that's what we did. Multiple connections and HTTP pipelining. Multiple connections is clear. Okay? If you have multiple connections to your server, you can send multiple requests in parallel, and then the server, and this is the key point, will work for you in parallel. Hopefully, if the server is smart enough, it will work in parallel for those different requests. But that is not enough. In addition to that, another thing that you can do is use HTTP pipelining. This means that you can send, even if you have just one server working for you, you can send one request, and instead of waiting for the response, send immediately the next request. What will happen is that those requests will accumulate in the socket buffer of that server, of that web server. It will be working on the first one, but you are not waiting for the response. You can send many requests simultaneously. And the server will eventually process them and send you back the responses. The advantage of that is that you are not paying the price of the latency. You send many requests, and then you wait for many responses. But you didn't wait for all the responses. You can wait just once, for example. So that's the idea. So we implemented that in version 4 of the SDK. And we implemented that using the idea of the concept of a future, something that was mentioned in another talk today when we talked about asynchronous input-output. The idea is that instead of sending a request and getting immediately the response, what you get back is a future object. And with that future object, you can later wait for the response. So this is what we have here in this example. Okay? You have the ID of a VM. You locate the service that manages that VM. And then you invoke the get method, but with that wait equals false. That means I don't want to wait for the response. Just give me the future so that later I can use it to get the response. Okay. how this works is that this request is sent. This is the actual code of the SDK. We are using the, as an underlying library, we're using libc URL and the pyc URL library as a wrapper around that. And this is how we implement it, okay? This library has the concept of two interfaces, a simple, easy interface that you can use to send the requests synchronously, and another multi-interface that you can use to send multiple requests simultaneously. So we take advantage of that. When you send something, this is just sent to the library. And nothing happens, really. Nothing is sent to the network yet. Okay. So we send that, and then the application receives something like this, receives an instance of this object. It's a future. It's not the real object. It's a future that we can use later to wait for the response. So sometime later, your application will call the wait method to wait for the response. And an important thing here is that what will happen here really is that when you send something, nothing happens. Nothing is sent through the network. All the work happens when you call wait. When you call wait, the SDK tells the library, go and perform all the work that is pending. And if you or when you receive the response for this particular request, tell me. Okay? So that's the idea. We send the request, and then we get later the response just calling wait. Again, I insist that the key point here is that when you send, nothing happens. All the work is performed when you call the wait method. And there may be many requests pending there. And that wait method may execute all of those requests that are pending, including the one that you are interested in. Okay. And an important characteristic of this way of doing things is that there are no multiple threads here. You don't need multiple threads, and you don't need multiple processes. All you need to do is write your program so that it will send multiple requests, and later it will wait for all of them. This is the idea of the wait method. It's just using the libcurl, the libc URL library to just perform the task. And it's returning when it finds that the task that we're interested on is completed. Okay. What does that mean in terms of performance? Remember that this is especially important when you have a high latency in your environment. If your environment is very close to your client, then this is not that important. But if it's long away, if there is a latency, that is very important. Those are real results from an environment with 200 milliseconds latency. Using the normal mechanism, the sequential requests, this is what it takes, 10, 20 seconds. Using the mechanism that uses this future and wait, it is reduced to 3 seconds. Basically, because your application is not waiting, is not paying the price of all the latencies, one after the other. It's waiting just once for all the responses. This is how the code looks like. It's a bit more involved because you have to do things like this. Okay? The idea is that in this case, I want to retrieve 100 VMs, and I want to retrieve also the network interface cards of those VMs. The way I do it is that I'm going to create a bunch of futures. Okay? So for each VM, I create a future. I do something like this. I get I get the list of VMs, and then in order to retrieve the NICs, I'm saying I want to get the list of NICs, but I don't want to wait yet. And I need to remember that the correspondence between the VM and the NICs somewhere. Here we're using a dictionary to hold that correspondence. And later, we are just waiting for everything. Okay? So we are calling that wait method multiple times. The first time that we call that wait method, we will get from the server maybe the response for the second request, maybe for the third, but we will keep working. That wait method will keep working till we get the response for the first request, and then it will return. Then I'm calling it to get the response for the second request. Maybe it's already there, it will return immediately. maybe it's not there yet. It will continue working till it is there. So finally, when we end this loop, all the responses are there. Okay? And I didn't have to wait for all of them. Remember that the idea here is not paying the price of the latency, not staying like this, waiting for each response. Okay? Staying like this, but only at the end, when you already sent all the requests. And that's it.